go.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day.
There are so many smiling faces out there this morning. Look around, look around. So many smiling faces. This is the last day of 2023. We're going to bring in a whole new year, all new things that God's going to do in the whole next year that we don't know about that are exciting and great. And this is the day the Lord has made.
Yeah.
Amen. Let's sound like it. Let's go.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Is often called the weeping prophet in light of his prophecies. And then he writes this book we call the Book of Lamentations. It's laments over what's happening in Jerusalem. And in the middle of that book, he writes these words, which we'll be singing in a moment. He says, "This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope." In the midst of the enemy attacking Jerusalem, in the midst of all the challenges, he says, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion. Therefore will I have hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to them that seeketh him." And that's why we sing, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases."
Steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. Never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness.
Steadfast word.
Never come to an end.
Father, as we gather this morning, we gather in light of the realization that this is the day that the Lord has made. And our response is we will rejoice and be glad in it. We will rejoice and be glad in it because of your faithfulness. We will rejoice and be glad in it because your mercies are new every morning. Father, we have so much to live for. Regardless of the challenges in our lives, regardless of the incredible highs or the incredible lows of this past year, we are here to worship you. We're here to praise you. We're here to witness your faithfulness. We are here to experience those new mercies. Father, I pray that you would touch every heart here today. As we come into your presence, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Take a few moments and greet one another this morning.
My hands high.
Better is one day in your house.
those last two songs are based upon the Psalms, Psalm 3 and Psalm 84. What a glorious thing that we can sing God's word back to Him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for worship that is directly from your word. Father, for when we speak your truth, when we worship in truth, we find ourselves in the center of your will. Worship that is biblical. Worship that is acceptable unto you. Father, thank you for the privilege of us gathering this morning to be of one mind, of one purpose, and that is to exalt you. Now I pray, Father, for the ministry of your word this morning, that it would penetrate heart and mind, that we might receive it, and that we might live according to it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As you're being seated, the children may be dismissed for Children's Church. Let me begin with two disclaimers this morning. The first is I'm still trying to get used to my new prescription with my glasses. And so this has been an adjustment these last two Sundays. So if I have that deer in the headlight look, it's intentional. My second disclaimer is simply this. Some of you receive the message via mail. Kathy mails that out with my weekly letter on Thursdays. I'm just warning you that there have been major revisions since Thursday's sermon went out. So if you happen to have it with you, or you look at it saying, this is not what he was preaching this morning, I'm just letting you know why. I love when the end of the year is on a Sunday, or when it begins on a Sunday. Being able to gather here this morning on this final day of 2023 is perfect timing. This is my third favorite Sunday of the year to preach. My first is Easter, and it's because of obviously what we celebrate, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. My second favorite Sunday of the year to preach is the one closest to my Christian birthday, because I'm reminded of the fact that God, in his grace and mercy, called me out of darkness into his marvelous light. But when we get to end the year together or begin a new year together, I love being with the church family. Because this day serves as a bridge, as a transition, because we get to reflect upon this past year, and you know how much I believe in reflection, but we also get to gather with a sense of anticipation for the coming year. And so being together here is both a time of reflection and anticipation. And so when I saw what the calendar provided for me, a couple of months ago, I began working on this message. But then something happened, and that is, as I went to the text, that the text was not giving me what I thought it was going to give me. And so I had a topic, I had a text, but they weren't quite matching up. And so my responsibility as a pastor teacher is to submit to the text. And that's exactly what I'm going to do this morning. I'm no less excited, it's just a different message than what I originally began planning a couple of months ago. And so I invite you to open up your Bibles to the Gospel of Matthew, specifically Matthew chapter 26. Page 1219, if you're using the Bibles of the pews. We will only be here briefly. I'm not preaching from Matthew, but I want to set the context for the text that I will be preaching on. So in Matthew chapter 26, Jesus is with his disciples in the upper room. He has celebrated Passover. He has instituted communion. They're getting ready to leave to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. And it is there that Jesus will be arrested. Throughout the evening and early morning hours, he will endure 6 trials, 3 religious trials, 3 civil trials, all of which were illegal according to Jewish law. He will then be beaten. He will be scourged. He will have a thorn of crowns planted firmly on his head. He will carry his cross partway to Golgotha, and then he will be crucified. Jesus, being fully God, knows all of which is about to happen. Look with me in verse 30. It says in Matthew 26, verse 30, and when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Have you ever wondered what hymn they sung? I have. It's a familiar passage. We often refer to it at communion times. It says, and when they sung a hymn, then they went out. And I've been wondering, what hymn did they sing? And why are we not told? I have the answer for you this morning. And I love being a Christian for as long as I have, and I'm learning new things. And when you realize what hymn they sung, in light of what Jesus was about to experience, I hope it touches your heart and mind like it has mine. Now, if you will, turn to the Old Testament book, the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms is and was the book of worship for the Jews. It contains 150 chapters. As I previously have shared, it's divided into 5 sections. Each section ends with a doxology. Those 5 sections correspond to the first 5 books of the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. David is the primary, but not the only author. In fact, the time period for which the book of Psalms was written covers over 1,000 years. And the key chapter, the key psalm of all of them, is Psalm 100, because it teaches us the why and how of worship. Specifically, why do we worship God and how are we to worship God? But I'll be preaching from Psalm 118. Just a single verse. The author of the psalm is not named, nor is the setting or the occasion named. But here's what we do know. It's part of a group of psalms. In fact, there are 3 groups of psalms. Psalms 113 through 118, Psalm 120 through 136, and Psalm 146 through 150. This is important for us to understand the context. These groups of psalms were sung at the feast and festivals in the Old Testament. Here's where it gets interesting. Psalm 113, Psalm 114, and Psalm 115 were all sung at the beginning of the Passover celebration. Psalm 117 and Psalm 118 were sung at the end of the Passover meal. And so when it says, when they sung a hymn, then they went out towards the Mount of Olives. The last hymn they would have sung, according to Jewish tradition, would have been Psalm 118. And so as we look at Psalm 118, we will look at it from the perspective, Jesus and his disciples are in the upper room singing this together after the Passover meal, after the initiated communion, and before all the events of Jesus' final hours. We're going to look just at a verse, but to give you the big picture of the 29 verses, the first four verses are a call to worship. Verses 5 through 21 are personal praise. And then verses 22 through 24, corporate or congregational praise. And then verses 25 through the end, a commitment to praise. And I know I've shared a lot with you, but the setting is so important if we are to understand the verse. We're going to be looking at verse 24, but we will read verses 22, 23, and 24. Let's stand together, please. Psalm 118, beginning in verse 22. The stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. May the Lord bless the reading of this word. You may be seated. Verse 22 references Jesus' future work as the Messiah, where it says, the stone which the builders refused or rejected has become the headstone of the corner. Jesus himself quotes this in the Gospel of Matthew, the 21st chapter, referencing himself. Verse 23 is the initial response, focuses first on the sovereignty of God. This is the Lord's doing. And then second of all, the response of man. It is marvelous in our eyes. That brings us to verse 24. It begins simply this way. This is the day. Now we have to understand, from a biblical perspective, the word day is used two ways. It's used sometimes in reference to an extended period of time. For instance, when we read the day of the Lord, referencing all the events and the chronology of those events during end times. That's the day of the Lord. It is also used referencing a 24-hour time period. In fact, this is what Jesus emphasizes in the Sermon on the Mount, in the last part of Matthew chapter 6, when he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And he says, take no thought of tomorrow. He's focusing on that 24-hour period. He's saying, today, this day is where our focus is to be. Yesterday is forever gone. Tomorrow is a hope we have this day. Remember what I said in my introduction. Jesus and his disciples had just celebrated Passover and communion. And according to the custom of the Jews, this is the last hymn they would have sung before the events. And so Jesus would have been singing, this is the day, knowing full well all that awaited him. The second part of that phrase, this is the day which the Lord has made. Now, as Christians, I would hope that we believe in the creation story of Genesis chapters 1 and 2. But sometimes we look back and think, okay, well, that was God, he created, and that's that. In fact, there's a whole theology, deism, which basically says God created heaven and earth and then stepped back and is just watching. Now, God created heaven and earth. He created each day. He has gifted us each day, and he's actively involved in each day. Let me take this a step further, and I want to quote from Mark Batterson's book, Win the Day. I thought this was so cool. He says, planet Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles per hour while speeding through space at 66,000 miles per hour. How do we not get dizzy? He continues, your ability to maintain balance is absolutely astounding. And even, this will encourage a lot of you, even on days when you feel like you didn't get much done, you did travel 1.6 million miles through space. Let me make this even more personal. We each take about 23,000 breaths per day. Your heart will beat more than 100,000 times today, circulating 5 quarts of blood through 100,000 miles of arteries and veins and capillaries. 37 sextillion chemical reactions are happening in your body at any given time. The combined DNA in all the cells in your body could stretch to the sun and back 61 times. He then concludes, there are no ordinary days. Every day is nothing short of a miracle. And the psalmist says, this is the day which the Lord has made. Today is the day the Lord has made. Today is the day the Lord has gifted to us, and today is the day that the Lord is actively involved in your life. And then there's this transition, this bridge. The first part of the verse is a statement of fact. This is the day which the Lord has made. That's a fact. The latter part of the verse is our commitment to action in light of the facts. Look with me at the text. Verse 24, this is a day which the Lord hath made. The first reaction, the first commitment, we will rejoice. Individually, collectively, we will be joyful. The word joy is at the root word. It's the root word to rejoice. The psalmist says, we will rejoice. Note what is missing. There is no mention of circumstances. He does not say, we will rejoice when, fill in the blank. No. He says, in light of the facts, this is a day which the Lord has made, our first commitment to action is we will rejoice. We will be joyful. I'm not going to have you turn there, but Jesus carries this theme in the Gospel of John when he says this in John chapter 15, verse 11. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Literally, that your joy might be overflowing. Where did Jesus share those words? In the upper room. Just hours before the final hours of his life. Paul carries this theme in his writings, Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. David, who was no stranger to trials and tribulations, to struggles, to the loss of family members, he writes in Psalm 16, verse 11, you will show me the path of life, for in your presence, speaking of God, in your presence, there is fullness of joy. You see, from the Old Testament to the New, joy, regardless of circumstances, is a thing. I love how Paul summarizes this. In Romans chapter 14, he says, for the kingdom of God, meaning the presence of God, is not meat nor drink. But what is the presence of God? What is the kingdom of God? Righteousness, right living, peace, a peace that comes from him, and joy in the Holy Spirit. There is no true joy apart from God. So the psalmist says, this is the day which the Lord has made. Our first commitment to action, we will rejoice. And if that's not enough, he says in Psalm 118, and be glad in it. Literally, we will delight in it. We will have pleasure in the day. Notice what is missing. There is no mention of circumstances. There is no conditional clause that says, as long as this is happening. No. Statement of fact, commitment to action. We will rejoice, we will have joy, and we will delight. How can that be? Listen to what David wrote in Psalm 37. Delight, be glad also in the Lord, and he will give thee the desires of your heart. Commit your way unto the Lord, trust in him, and he will bring it to pass. This is what the psalmist is saying to us on this final day. He's giving us the facts. This is the day, December 31st. This is the day which the Lord has made and gifted to us, and our response, regardless of circumstances, we will rejoice and we will be glad in it. Now, some of you have had horrible years. Some of you gathered here have gone through unspeakable tragedies. And it is very easy for you to hear these words and discount them or just put a wall up and say, this can't be true. That's why the context is so critical. Knowing that this song, these words, came out of the mouth of Jesus hours before his arrest and betrayal, before his trials, before being beaten and spit upon, before being whipped, before the crown was placed on his head, before he was forced to carry the cross, before his disciples all fled and abandoned him in his greatest time of need, and before he hung on the cross, in which he cried out to his Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? For the first time in all of eternity, the Father could not look upon the Son. You know why? Because he took our sins upon himself, and God could not look upon that. And it's the Father turning away from the Son. And in that context, Jesus said, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice, and we will be glad in it. See, he wasn't counting on how he felt. He was rather making a commitment regardless of how he felt. I in no way, please understand, I in no way am minimizing what some of you have been going through. Please, please don't take that. I'm simply saying, God knows. Jesus knew. And his commitment in response remains steadfast. No one has ever said the Christian life would be easy. But you have heard me say over and over again, it's not that complicated. Basketball Hall of Fame coach John Wooden said, make each day your masterpiece. Because yesterday is history. Can't change a thing about it. Tomorrow is a hope, a desire, but it's certainly not a guarantee. We have today. And so he says, make each day your masterpiece. How do we do that? I believe it's simply by beginning with the biblical perspective. Understanding this is the day that God has given to us. This is the day that God has made. That's the biblical perspective, is understanding the gift of each day and then a commitment to respond in light of the gift of each day. And so I'm going to encourage you three things. Three things in light of what the psalmist writes. Number one, commit this passage to memory. In fact, I've probably said it 20 times already. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. It's not very difficult. In fact, we began this worship service by singing. It's one of the great ways to memorize scripture through song. So commit it to memory. My second encouragement to you is thoughtfully, slowly, meditatively begin your day reciting the passage you have memorized. Could you imagine before you leave the bed, while your feet are just on the floor and you're sitting in the bed, just pausing, taking that deep breath and saying, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." But I would encourage you to take it a step further and personalize it by saying, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." In fact, I was here early this morning opening up the church thinking about this message, and I thought, could you imagine for you husbands and wives that get up at the same time? Could you imagine before you start the craziness of your day, husband and wife sitting next to each other, hand in hand, reciting together, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." Could you imagine a parent gathering his children, gathering their children before school, before they go out into the world as we know it, and the family gathering for just a few moments together, refocusing, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." See, step one is committing it to memory. Step two is beginning your day with it. Step three, reminding yourself of it. It's interesting when you look at the life of Daniel. We're told in the book of Daniel, three times a day he was on his knees praying to God. In Psalm 119, 164, the psalmist writes, "Seven times a day will I praise thee." I don't know about you, but sometimes my day begins in a blaze of glory, only to go south very quickly. And sometimes I need to remind myself that God is still on the throne. And I'm a pastor who spends most of his day by himself. Okay? But I go back to my days when I worked the different jobs I did before coming here. And here's what I know. Not everybody out there is hoping and encouraging you to have the best day of your life. In fact, there are many people you encounter on a daily basis who believe it's their mission that you do not have a masterpiece of a day. I'm not asking for a raise of hands because some of you work together. So what I am saying is the fact we need to remind ourselves during the day, yeah, this is still the day. This is still the day that God has made. And this is still the day I will rejoice and be glad in it. So as this year's drawn to a close, three things. Memorize a verse, begin your day with a verse, and sometime during the day, remind yourself of the passage. What a great way to end this year. What an even greater way to begin the next year. Living in light of eternal truth. For every day that you have breath, it is a day that the Lord has made. It is a day the Lord has gifted to you. That's a fact. Commit yourself to live in light of the facts. I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. Regardless. Regardless of the circumstances. Because by the grace of God, every day is a day of rejoicing. And every day is a day to delight in the one who has gifted you that day. Let's pray. Father, we as a church have sung these words countless number of times. It has only been this week that I discovered the context of these words in light of the life of Jesus. I pray, Father, that we would never look at this simple verse in the same way. I pray even more that we would walk in obedience, that we would live in light of the truth. And that we would pray and encourage others to live in light of this truth. Thank you, Father, for just putting this message on my heart. Thank you for allowing me to spend this year with this incredible church family. Thank you for the privilege of being together with them as this year draws to a close and as we have great anticipation of the new year. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before the worship team comes forward, I need to explain something. On the 21st of December, Kathy and I, and there were some others from Community Bible Church, went to a Christmas concert at McIntyre Hall. And in the midst of that concert, the person leading it was born again, spirit-filled, just on fire for the Lord. And so it was truly a Christmas Christian concert. During that concert, he invited us to participate in the singing of a song. How many of you have at least heard the song that is typically sung on New Year's Eve, Auld Lang Syne? You're familiar with the tune. As I have been most of my life. That night on the 21st, we sung that same tune with different words. And that's what we're going to do tonight or today. The tune is familiar. We've all heard it. For the first time, for many of you, you're going to sing words to it that you fully understand. And here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to invite the worship team to sing the first verse and refrain. And then for the second verse, the worship team will continue to sing, and the men will stand up and join the worship team for the second verse and refrain. And then on the final verse, the ladies will stand up. Worship team, men, and women. And I'm hoping this morning we can take a familiar tune and worship God with glorious words. You remain seated while the worship team comes up.
done, his kingdom come, on earth as is above. Who is himself our daily bread, praise him, the Lord of love. Let living water satisfy the thirsty without pride.
May that be the testimony of our lives individually. May that be the testimony of this church family. All glory be to Christ. God bless you and happy New Year.